from its discovery in the depths of space to what makes it special in terms of composition and more. Allow us to show you Ariel, Uranus's brightest moon. Number 10. The discovery of Ariel. In terms of its finding, Ariel was discovered on October 24, 1851 by William Lassell. It is named for a sky spirit in an Alexander Pope story in Shakespeare's The Tempest, which is not too uncommon given the power that literature and mythology have in regards to naming things like this. Both Ariel and the slightly larger Uranian satellite Umbriel were discovered by William Lassell on the same day, believe it or not. Although William Herschel, who discovered Uranus's two largest moons, Titania and Oberon, in 1787, claimed to have observed four additional moons. This was never confirmed, and those four objects are now thought to be spurious. If you look at the history of finding planets and moons, you'll find similar stories of astronomers trying to get credit because of believed discoveries. All of Uranus's moons are named after characters from the works of William Shakespeare or Alexander Pope. The names of all four satellites of Uranus, then known, were suggested by John Herschel in 1852 at the request of Lassell. Ariel is named after the leading sylph in one of Pope's stories. It is also the name of the spirit who serves Prospero in Shakespeare's The Tempest. The moon is also designated Uranus I, which is a more generalized title to help show which moons were discovered in what order and is a common thing across multiple moons of various planets. Number 9. Its surface. All of Uranus's larger moons, including Ariel, are thought to consist mostly of roughly equal amounts of water, ice, and silicate rock. Carbon dioxide has also been detected on Ariel, which is important in helping determine various things about the moon itself. Ariel's surface appears to be the youngest of all the moons of Uranus. That is believed because it has few large craters and many small ones, indicating that fairly recent low-impact collisions wiped out the large craters that would have been left by much earlier, bigger strikes. You might think, but why does that matter? Scientists like to use impact craters to help determine certain things about the surface, as well as indications of where to look for materials of asteroids or meteors that might have pelted the surface of certain moons or planets, because getting samples of them can help tell a timeline for various things, including the history of the planet. Ariel is also thought to have the most recent geologic activity of Uranus's larger moons. It is transected by grabens, which are fault-bounded valleys. Ariel has the brightest surface of the five largest Uranian moons, but none of them reflect more than about a third of the sunlight that strikes them. This suggests that their surfaces have been darkened by a carbonaceous material. Ariel's brightness increases dramatically when it is in opposition. That is when the observer is directly between it and the sun. This indicates that its surface is porous, casting reflectivity, decreasing shadows when illuminated at other angles. This is another curious thing that scientists like to study, as it can help determine how the moon came to be and the events that led to its current form. Number 8. Rotations and orbits. Among Uranus's five major moons, Ariel is the second closest to the planet, orbiting at a distance of about 190,000 kilometers or over 118,000 miles. Its orbit has a small eccentricity and is inclined very little relative to the equator of Uranus. Its orbital period is around 2.5 Earth days, coincident with its rotational period. This means that one side of the moon always faces the planet, a condition known as tidal lock, which is a key thing in regards to temperature. More on that later. Ariel's orbit lies completely inside the Uranian magnetosphere. The trailing hemispheres, those facing away from their directions of orbit, of airless satellites orbiting inside a magnetosphere like Ariel are struck by magnetosphere plasma, co-rotating with the planet. This bombardment may lead to the darkening of the trailing hemispheres observed for all Uranian moons except Oberon. Ariel also captures magnetospheric charged particles, producing a pronounced dip in energetic particle count near the moon's orbit observed by Voyager 2 in 1986. Number 7. Observation and exploration. The only close-up images of Ariel were obtained by the Voyager 2 probe, one of the most important scientific tools in the history of the space program, which photographed the moon during its flyby of Uranus in January of 1986. The closest approach of Voyager 2 to Ariel was 127,000 kilometers, 79,000 miles, significantly less than the distances to all other Uranian moons except Miranda. The best images of Ariel have a spatial resolution of about 2 kilometers. They cover about 40% of the surface, but only 35% was photographed with the quality required for geological mapping and crater counting, meaning that there is a lot more to learn from the surface of the moon. At the time of the flyby, the southern hemisphere of Ariel, like those of the other moons, was pointed towards the sun, so the northern, dark hemisphere could not be studied. No other spacecraft has ever visited the Uranian system. The possibility of sending the Cassini spacecraft to Uranus was evaluated during its mission extension planning phase. It would have taken about 20 years to get to the Uranian system after departing Saturn, and these plans were scrapped in favor of remaining at Saturn and eventually destroying the spacecraft in Saturn's atmosphere. What this means, on the whole, is that there could be a chance to go and try to do a closer flyby for the moon should the opportunity arise, especially with the desire to further go and explore our solar system growing with every year as we potentially get closer to sending a craft to Mars and other potentially viable spots in the solar system. If done correctly, it might not just go and help explore Ariel, but also explore the other moons of Uranus. But whether this actually happens is up for debate. Before we continue, be sure to like or dislike the video and subscribe to the channel. That way we can continue to try and make the best videos possible for you, the viewers. Number 6. Atmosphere. Despite there being carbon dioxide on the moon of Ariel in some capacity, there is no detectable atmosphere or magnetosphere that we can find. While this may be on the surface sound like an okay thing, it's honestly not. Because when you want to look for a place to live in the universe, an atmosphere is preferable for a variety of reasons. Without it and the magnetic field, that means that not only will anything on the surface be open to getting hit by various cosmic rays, it makes it all the more likely that asteroids and meteors will bombard the place. Which, if you recall, is something we know happens on Ariel, especially with the smaller space rocks. Now, to be clear, this doesn't make it the most uninhabitable place ever, but it is a major deterrent in terms of explorations and wanting to go there for one reason or another to colonize. Number 5. Surface temperature. Measurements have shown that Ariel's surface temperature rises and falls quickly with the coming and going of sunlight, without a thermal inertial lag. That supports the picture of a porous surface, which would tend to insulate the moon and keep the subsurface from heating up. This texture could be the result of eons of micrometeorite strikes tilling the soil. In an earlier time, Ariel appears to have undergone enough heating to allow differentiation, a separation in which heavier materials sink towards the core and lighter material floats at or near the surface. Models indicate that tidal interactions with Uranus may provide an important source of heat. But whether that heat is enough to do certain things, including live on the surface, by channeling that heat is up for debate. But given how the moon is in tidal lock and that the temperatures rise and fall, it's unlikely. Number 4. Seasons. Because Ariel, like Uranus, orbits the sun almost on its side relative to its rotation, its northern and southern hemispheres face either directly towards or directly away from the sun at the solstices. This means it is subject to an extreme seasonal cycle, just as Earth's poles see permanent night or daylight around the solstices. So Ariel's poles see permanent night or daylight for half a Uranian year, 42 Earth years, with the sun rising close to the zenith over one of the poles at each solstice. The Voyager 2 flyby coincided with the 1986 Southern Summer Solstice, when nearly the entire northern hemisphere was dark. Once every 42 years, when Uranus has an equinox and its equatorial plane intersects the Earth, mutual occultations of Uranus's moons become possible. A number of such events occurred in 2007-2008, including an occultation of Ariel by Umbriel on August 19, 2007. Number 3. Composition. Ariel is the fourth largest of the Uranian moons and may have the third greatest mass. Its density indicates that it consists of roughly equal parts water ice and a dense non-ice component, which could consist of rock and carbonaceous material, including heavy organic compounds known as tholins. The presence of water ice is supported by infrared spectroscopic observations, which have revealed crystalline water ice on the surface of the moon, which is porous and thus transmits little solar heat to layers below. Water ice absorption bands are stronger on Ariel's leading hemisphere than on its trailing hemisphere. The cause of this asymmetry is not known, but it may be related to bombardment by charged particles from Uranus's magnetosphere. The energetic particles tend to sputter water ice, decompose methane trapped in ice as clathrate hydrate, and darken other organics, leaving a dark carbon-rich residue behind. Except for water, the only other compound identified on the surface of Ariel by infrared spectroscopy is carbon dioxide, CO2, which is concentrated mainly on its trailing hemisphere. Ariel shows the strongest spectroscopic evidence for CO2 of any Uranian satellite, and was the first Uranian satellite on which this compound was discovered. The origin of the carbon dioxide is not completely clear, and as we noted, there is no atmosphere to contain it or make sure it's near the surface. It might be produced locally from carbonates or organic materials under the influence of the energetic charged particles coming from Uranus's magnetosphere or solar ultraviolet radiation. This hypothesis would explain the asymmetry in its distribution, as the trailing hemisphere is subject to a more intense magnetosphere influence than the leading hemisphere. Another possible source is the outgassing of primordial CO2 trapped by water ice in Ariel's interior. The escape of CO2 from the interior may be related to past geological activity on this moon. Number 2. Origins of Ariel. As with all bodies in the sky, many wondered how the moons of certain planets formed. Ariel is thought to have formed from an accretion disk or subnebula, a disk of gas and dust that either existed around Uranus for some time after its formation or was created by the giant impact that most likely gave Uranus its large obliquity. Significant amounts of carbon and nitrogen may have been present in the form of carbon monoxide, Cl, and molecular nitrogen, N2, instead of methane and ammonia. The moons that formed in such a subnebula would contain less water ice, with Cl and N2 trapped as clathrate, and more rock explaining the higher density. The accretion process probably lasted for several thousand years before the moon was fully formed, and ever since its forming, there have been rocks pelting the surface, including canyons that may have been around for about 200 million years. Number 1. Will we go to Ariel? As noted previously, there is a large desire to go and try to make our presence felt throughout the solar system, and there are certain moons out there that might just serve our needs. However, whether Ariel is one of them is up for debate. Without an atmosphere, there are immediate problems involving gas and protection. The tidally locked rotation doesn't help either. Add to that, while there has been water detected on the moon, it's unclear if it's reachable in certain areas or will be able to be processed into drinkable amounts. Not to mention Uranus is the seventh planet in the solar system, and at present it would take many years to get from Earth to it in a probe, let alone a colony vessel. It's not out of the question, but it is definitely a place that is on the back burner right now, if you will. What did you think of this look at Ariel? Do you see why it's such a special moon to the planet Uranus? What was your favorite fact you learned? Leave your comments down below and subscribe to our channel right now for more incredible videos.